Welcome to CFRI's Cystic Fibrosis Community Voices, a video podcast series created by and for the cystic fibrosis community.
Everyone knows who you are.
All right, thank you everyone for having me here. I'm excited to share some of my work that I've done on motivational interviewing with parents and providers. I am so happy to be here. I thank CFRI for inviting me out here from Virginia. We met at the NACFC conference in Denver this past fall and have been communicating over email. I feel like I know her and her daughter Tess, and I'm just really excited to share this work with all of you. It's a real privilege to be surrounded by so many incredible patients and families, clinicians, researchers, and treatment developers. This truly is such an exciting time in the world of CF, and a hopeful time in the world of CF. But despite the advancements in treatments, the burden of care remains high. There are still so many things that children, adolescents, young adults, and adults with CF have to do on a day-to-day basis to take care of themselves and live their best lives, from taking medications, doing airway clearance, taking enzymes, making sure they're eating enough, making sure they're exercising enough, making sure they're, infection control. And it's a lot day to day. And I think this oftentimes can produce a lot of stress for patients and their families, and a lot of stress in their communication at home. And so my goal when I was working in the CF Center at University of North Carolina in Chapel Hill was to take what I knew about positive and effective communication skills as a health provider and translate those into sharing those with parents and family members, because as we all know, parents and family members are as equal a part of the healthcare team as anybody else on the team, and so why not give them the same skills and tools? I mean, there's plenty to go around. There's no need to be selfish about it. So working as a clinical psychologist in pediatric CF centers, two of the biggest kind of reasons for referral or questions I got were usually, one, Dr. Islam, there's a patient crying. Can you go talk to them? So usually a provider who was uncomfortable or unsure of what to do with the strong emotions that come along with CF. And the other issues were mainly related to adherence, so behavioral concerns, issues that parents were having with their kids and teenagers with taking their medications or doing their treatments, and how it was affecting their relationship at home. And so oftentimes people would say to me, can you help me motivate this patient? As though I had like a magic wand that I could motivate them. And I wish that I did have that, but motivation is not it's not black and white, it's not all or nothing. It's a dynamic thing, it's on a continuum. And so I think oftentimes I would hear from providers and parents, you know, that their kids just weren't motivated. And that's just simply not true. Everyone is motivated to move toward positive changes for themselves. It's figuring out not how to motivate them, because I can't motivate you. I can help you figure out what is motivating to you and the reasons why this is important to you, and to build and develop the confidence and the skills to make the changes that you need to in your life. So a little bit of background about me. So appreciate the introduction. I am now in private practice in Richmond, Virginia. So I work with kids with all types of different chronic illnesses and those without. And a lot of the work that I'm presenting today has been done at two different institutions, Virginia Commonwealth University, where I did my graduate training, and then University of North Carolina in Chapel Hill, where I did my residency and postdoctoral fellowship, which was partially funded by a grant from the CF Foundation, which made it possible for me to explore some of these research questions that I had while I was at UNC. So a little overview of what I would like to do today. So I want to make sure that everyone in this room has kind of a basic understanding, and everyone listening at home has a basic understanding of motivational interviewing, what that is. I don't expect anyone to leave here an expert in MI, but that's kind of my point, is that everyone can benefit from knowing a little bit more about these skills. You don't have to be an expert in it. You don't have to go to an all-day training on MI. You don't have to be a health provider to know about motivational interviewing and what it is. I want to share the gospel with everyone. And again, I'm just so thankful that this is another opportunity or platform where I can do that from. So you'll learn about some of the basic motivational interviewing concepts and skills that can help facilitate behavior change with patients and loved ones. And I'll also share a little bit about some of the feasibility pilot studies that I did with some of the benefits of just offering very brief, short MI trainings to health providers and CF clinics. And also to family members in CF clinics. So, what is motivational interviewing? I've mentioned it a lot, but what is it? MI is a style of collaborative communication designed to facilitate behavior change by eliciting change talk. That's kind of the formal definition, but even as I say that out loud, I'm like, what does that mean to somebody? So, essentially, MI is a way of being with another person. It is a way of listening to another person. It is a way of talking to another person that is a partnership. It's a collaboration that helps that person to figure out how it is that they will go about making changes for themselves and why it is they want to do that for themselves. It's very different from the traditional medical model of information delivery. I'm going to tell you information, I'm going to tell you what to do with it, and I expect you to do it because I've told you so. That doesn't work very well with teenagers especially, or with anyone, because again, when it comes to behavior change, a lot more is about motivation than about information. So a little bit of background on motivational interviewing, what it is, where it came from. This is a technique that was developed in the world or field of clinical psychology and in the world of addictions treatment. So developed by psychologists William Miller and Stephen Rolnick in the context of treating people with addictions and substance abuse. Built on Carl Rogers, who's another famous psychologist, his person-centered approach that really highlights valuing the individual's autonomy, accepting where the person is and meeting them where they are in the process of change, providing unconditional love and acceptance, a non-judgmental approach that helps people to self-actualize, which is a fancy psychology word for basically moving toward fulfilling one's full potential. And I think this quote really captures the heart of listening in motivational interviewing, which I think is one of the most powerful components of it. We think we listen, but very rarely do we listen with real understanding and empathy. Yet listening of this very special kind is one of the most potent forces for change that I know. So I have a short video next that I'd like to share that kind of highlights what I mean by listening.
There's all this pressure, you know? And sometimes it feels like it's right up on me and I can just feel it, like literally feel it in my head, and it's relentless. And I don't know if it's gonna stop. I mean, that's the thing that scares me the most, is that I don't know if it's ever gonna stop.
Yeah. You do have a nail in your head.
It is not about the nail.
Are you sure? Because, I mean, I'll bet if we got that out of there.
Stop trying to fix it.
No, I'm not trying to fix it. I'm just pointing out that maybe the nail is causing.
You always do this. You always try to fix things when what I really need is for you to just listen. No,
see, I don't think that is what you need. I think what you need is to get the nail
out. See, you're not even listening now.
Okay, fine. I will listen. Fine.
It's just. Sometimes it's like there's this achy, I don't know what it is, and I'm not sleeping very well at all, and all my sweaters are snagged. I mean, all of them.
That sounds really hard.
It is. Thank you.
Ow!
Come on, if you would just—
Don't! Try to see things my way. Do I have to keep on
talking to— How many can relate to that? Mm-hmm.
So sometimes what you need is for someone to just listen and be there. And oftentimes listening and being there can open up the door to, for someone to actually be able to hear you and to kind of invite your support or welcome your support. And so when you kind of meet someone immediately with problem solving and fixing it for them, or telling them how easy it would be for things to just go differently. If they could just get the nail out of their head, things would be so much better. And that creates a lot of defensiveness often, because it's not easy to make changes. And when you present solutions or offer kind of to fix it for people as though it's easy, and again, especially with teenagers and kids, they don't want that. And we don't want that for them either, because especially with adolescents and young adults and children, what we want is for them to be developing their own sense of problem solving and autonomy as they're growing older, to be able to kind of figure out for themselves what they need in order to make the changes that are important for them. And so what happens oftentimes in these clinical encounters and in these conversations at home is there's this kind of tug of war. There's this pull and tug. The more you try to get someone to do something, the less they want to do it. I hear from a lot of teenagers, like, I was going to do it, but then my mom told me to do it, so now I'm not going to do it just despite her. Like, there's, and this is a common dynamic between adolescents and their parents. It's not unique to CF. It's, you see it with getting homework done, cleaning your room, taking care of your chores around the house. And so this is a natural part of that period of adolescence, and it's also a natural part of life in general. So, you know, as I thought about preparing this presentation and making it more applicable to a wider audience and other loved ones, spouses, significant others of patients and individuals with CF, I realized that a lot of my video examples are really from marital communication strategies. A lot of times when I've given talks on motivational interviewing to healthcare providers, I would joke and I would tell them to go home and use this on their husbands or wives and to come back and tell me how it went. They're like, oh my gosh, this is great. And so I think it really is a universal kind of skill when it comes to listening and communicating that, again, is used widely in the health fields, but can really be applicable to all types of relationships and all types of issues. So oftentimes I would hear from parents and providers that they were frustrated, that they felt like they were a broken record, they were repeating themselves, they were tired of, especially parents, tired of CF dominating their relationships and conversations at home, that they felt like they were talking to a brick wall or like things were going in one ear and out the other. And that's a pretty frustrating position to be in. But some of the things and some of the strategies that healthcare providers and parents kind of default to try to get people to listen to them are some of these strategies that are real roadblocks to good listening. So especially I've highlighted and read some of the ones that we default to a lot. So warning or threatening about kind of the long-term consequences of CF, which again, the stakes are high. So of course you want to impart to your patients and to your loved ones and your kids how important it is for them to do these things. But also when you're working with kids and adolescents especially, their brains are not built to think about changing their behaviors for long-term payoffs or rewards. They are thinking about the day-to-day. I would rather go outside and play. I want to be with my friends. I'd like to go to the prom. And so warning and threatening about long-term consequences, especially with younger individuals, is oftentimes not as effective as kind of incentivizing with some of the short-term payoffs. You can play in your soccer game. You can hang out with your friends. You're going to be able to walk up the stairs without feeling breathless. So kind of tying their health behaviors to some of the more immediate benefits that they will actually experience in the short term, because everyone likes instant gratification. And there's not a whole lot about treatments that provide that kind of immediate reinforcement. Another roadblock to listening that we use a lot of and kind of default to is kind of advising or giving solutions. I think that's our natural instinct as healthcare providers and as parents is to want to fix it, is to want to make it better. And of course, when the solution is very obvious to another person, what you need to do is just get the nail out of your head. Of course, you're going to just want to help that person realize that. But if they don't realize it on their own, they're not as likely to actually make those changes. So a lot of the things that come about when you use those types of strategies on the previous slide are these kinds of responses that are really red flags in conversations. So when you're getting a lot of this from the person you're talking to, you're probably not being all that effective and kind of motivating them or helping them change. So you've probably heard a lot of these before. So the yes, but, that's a big one that we talk about in motivational interviewing. So if you're getting a lot of yes, but, you're not actually getting through to the person and helping them change. So a yes, but is when you explain something to someone and they say, yes, but, blah, 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 blah. This is why, you know, I can't do it, or this is why that's not gonna work for me. Discounting, I've already tried that. Unwillingness, I just don't want to do that. Blaming, it's not my fault, it's something else. Arguing and challenging. Minimizing, so kind of downplaying, this isn't that big of a deal. Kind of making excuses. The sort of passive agreement, yeah, I know. And then just the straight up ignoring that we get a lot of, which is like, what? I'm sorry, I wasn't paying attention, I was looking at my phone. So these are definitely things that happen a lot of when we kind of go on and on with some of the more traditional strategies of lecturing, advising, offering solutions, warning, and threatening. Traditionally, views on helping people change behaviors, again, come from this more paternalistic model of people should want to change. And health should be their primary motivator. They should want to do this for their health. I hear that a lot from parents where they're like, I want them to get why this is important for their health. Well, yeah, I want them to get that too. But if that's not what's gonna make changing this behavior click for them, I want whatever's gonna make them actually do this. Not, again, over time, that's something that they're gonna realize and understand. But right now, your five-year-old might not get that. That people are either motivated to change or not. So again, this is one of the most disheartening comments that I would hear. It's like, they're just not motivated. Again, motivated is not a black or white thing. And then this tremendous pressure that I think parents and providers feel to get someone to change. That if you don't get someone to change or get someone to do what they need to do, that you are in some way a failure. And that's a huge, huge onus of responsibility, especially in CF, that's a huge, heavy burden to carry. And again, oftentimes the more pressure and the more stress you place on that, the harder it is to actually make the changes that you want to see. So your job is actually to help your child or your loved one to find what's motivating and what matters to him or her. And again, with younger folks, this is usually more in terms of short-term benefits. They don't feel out of breath, they cough less, they can do better in their sports, they have more energy, it's easier for them to do well in school. Their parents aren't nagging them all the time. That was actually probably like the number one reason why kids would tell me that they were making changes or wanted to make changes, is so their parents would stop nagging them. So. Again, some of these are short-term reasons for change, but when they lead to the changes that you want them to make, it doesn't matter. You know, eventually they do grasp the long-term consequences on their health, but that's not what's going to make them change in that moment. This oftentimes leads to a lot of frustration, again, for parents and providers. So they feel like, again, they're beating their head against the wall. They don't get it. They're not motivated. They don't care. They don't listen. They're in denial. And this leaves you in a place of feeling pretty stuck. What else am I to do? I've tried everything. I've heard that many, many, many times. And again, the truth is, when it comes to making changes, there's naturally, normally, something called ambivalence. There's a part of you that wants to change and a part of you that doesn't want to change. Think about your New Year's resolutions. So, like, most of us have good intentions and reasons why we want to make changes in our lives, but it's oftentimes hard. It takes effort, it takes commitment, and it sometimes is not fun. And the more we pull on one side of why someone should do something, the more likely they are to kind of pull on the other side of, like, why they don't want to change. So it's sort of like this balance beam. And so the more you tug on the change side, the more they're going to pull back to kind of find that equilibrium. And so what you actually want to do is you want the person that you're trying to help improve their behaviors to actually do more of the change talk instead of you. So they should be doing more of the talking than you are. And when I say change talk, what I mean is people actually articulating, saying out loud, more about why they want to change, why they can change. And ultimately, this helps them actually become more likely to change. And the words and the behaviors that we use as the other person in the conversation can actually elicit more change talk. So change talk, this is a slide that I wish I had included, and I'm just going to make sure I tell you more about it here. Change talk, an acronym for it, is called Darn Cat. So the Darn Cat is someone's desire to change, their ability to change, their reasons for change, the need to change. Those are all kind of preparatory types of change talk. So what you want to do, and we'll talk about how to do this, is you want to be eliciting that type of change talk that is preparing this person to kind of contemplate why, for them, change is important. And then the cat part is more of like the actual kind of commitment language. So C is for commitment, A is for activation, which is like the readiness to change, and T is for taking steps, what the actual steps are that they're going to take, what are they going to do to change their behavior. And again, depending on how we respond to people and how we interact with them, we can actually create more change talk and elicit more change talk from a conversation, or we can create more resistance or ambivalence, so that more of that tug of war or ping pong pattern of, like, I'm telling you this and you're, you know, refuting that with kind of your point of view. What we want is more of like this coming alongside of being on the same page about why change is important, and kind of building that confidence and self-efficacy and being able to make these changes. So to kind of review, motivational interviewing is collaborative and it's goal-oriented. It's not just listening. It's also guiding someone towards change that they're ready for. It's designed to strengthen someone's internal motivation by exploring their own reasons for change within an atmosphere of acceptance and compassion. And it's designed to enhance commitment to a specific goal with a plan and the confidence to meet it. So it's this overall style of being and style of listening, but it's also a very goal-oriented, practical approach. And we're going to talk about some of the concrete strategies that you can use that get you to the point of a plan with confidence and commitment. The overall spirit of MI, there are kind of those technical skills that we'll talk about, but an overarching spirit with MI are kind of these four primary elements. So compassion, evocation, which is more of, again, eliciting that change talk and reasons for change from the person, partnership, so joining alongside them in this journey, and acceptance, accepting where they are, except not that they need to be kind of at the end finish line, but that maybe where they are right now is just taking one small step toward change. What MI looks like is it's more listening, less lecturing, more motivating, less nagging, more problem solving, less fixing it, and more of getting the person's buy-in and engagement in their treatment than trying to convince them. In terms of research on motivational interviewing, there is a lot of research that's out there on this style of communication. Over 1,000 controlled trials across different fields, addictions, chronic disease management, mental health, nutrition, dentistry, gambling, education, public health, you name it. There's really no other treatment approach that I can think of that has such wide application. And so again, this is one of the big reasons why I felt like it was so important to broaden the scope and the audience with which we were using these skills. So again, not just sharing them with other healthcare providers or other professionals, but parents and family members and loved ones that are on the front lines. If this is used so widely, and 2/3 of trials show a beneficial effect, 1/3 don't, but again, we're talking about like over 1,000 trials across all of these different areas, what else can you think of that has that kind of efficacy across so many different areas? There's great reason to share this with more people. And some of the research that I think also really supports this are studies that have shown that MI can be learned by anyone. One's ability to learn MI is not related to their years of professional education. And MI can be effective in very brief formats and incorporated into other activities. It's not a standalone treatment or intervention. It's really a way of doing what you do. So it's a way of being a physician, a way of being a nurse, a way of being a counselor or a psychologist or a parent. And I will say MI is not for everyone. It works for some people, not for others. So I think you do have to be authentic to yourself and also, you know, tuned into your relationship with your loved one. These are, again, techniques that I think I hope will be helpful for you to learn about today, but as with anything, you have to kind of incorporate it into your own style and make sure that it's a good fit for the person who's trying to make the changes. Fundamental principles of MI. So these are kind of the underlying principles, and then we'll get to some of the more concrete skills. Resist the writing reflex. So the writing reflex is that like instinctive feeling you have when you just want to jump in and say, no, just get the nail out of your head. And instead kind of roll with the resistance. This is a phrase that's used commonly in motivational interviewing. That means basically when you get that resistance, instead of pushing against it, try to kind of roll with it a little bit. And you'll actually find yourself kind of heading more toward a productive conversation than if you get into this kind of back and forth match. Understand their motivations and understand that these may be very different than yours. So again, a teenager's reason for doing their treatments may be more about kind of what they're doing that weekend than what their lung functioning is going to be like in 10 years. You know, with younger children, it was interesting kind of incorporating MI with parents of younger children. This can be true with younger children, too. So, like, there is a lot of support for kind of more basic behavioral interventions with younger children. So, using reward systems and incentives. So, that's part of their motivation. So, understanding that, getting their involvement and engagement in what is motivating or incentivizing to them if you're kind of putting together a reward plan or something like that. Then listening, so really listening, not the fake listening or I heard you, but really listening and reflecting, which is a skill we'll talk about, which helps to develop more true empathy and rapport. And empowering the individual. So ultimately, you're not the one who's going to be changing. They are. And so they have to feel like they have the confidence and the ability to do it. I think we have time for this. So this is one of the activities that I oftentimes do at the beginning of an MI training. And basically what I'm going to be going into now are some of the brief kind of skills that I teach people in MI trainings. And again, very similar for healthcare providers and for parents and loved ones. Same types of skills that I'm teaching to both folks. And this is an activity that I do at the beginning of a lot of MI trainings, but a lot of parent child communication trainings too. So it's called Your Best Boss. So world's best boss here. Think about your best boss and your worst boss. So what were some of the characteristics of your worst boss? What did you not like about them? And what were some of the characteristics of your best boss? What did you like about them? What made you want to work for them? What made you want to go to please them, to go to work each day, to make them proud? And usually, and sometimes people use this as like your best teacher, your worst teacher. Sometimes it's your best worst coach. Sometimes it's best boss, worst boss. You can think about any person in any of those categories, coach, teacher, boss. But really thinking about, again, what are the characteristics of someone that helped motivate you and feel good about the work that you were doing? And those are the characteristics. And most often, I think it'll be hard to kind of pull people in the audience here because of the microphone and getting up and all that stuff. So maybe we'll save that if we have time. But typically people will respond that their best bosses or their best teachers were people who really believed in them, that cared about them as a whole person, that listened to them and understood them, that valued them and their contributions, that recognized them and their contributions, so that pointed out when they were doing well. And those were the main things that people would really kind of remember and oftentimes very fondly about their favorite teacher or their favorite coach or their best boss. And then the things that people oftentimes characterized about the people that they did not like working with or for were not feeling valued or respected, always feeling like they were being criticized or called out for things, that things were never good enough, that the person didn't really see their perspective or their point of view, that they just kind of, that they just sort of barked commands at them. And so you can see how kind of this exercise can help someone to sort of realize, gosh, what are some of the things that I could be doing that would be more effective in motivating someone, and what are some of the things that I should be doing less of or might be doing that aren't actually that helpful? And again, I think when it comes to motivational interviewing, there's a lot of overlap between just good communication skills. So realizing how much overlap there is with parent-child communication interventions that I would do. So that's one of my favorite parenting books, How to Talk So Kids Will Listen and Listen So Kids Will Talk. A lot of that is motivational interviewing. And a lot of marital communication interventions. A lot of the communication strategies that are talked about in marital therapy have overlaps with motivational interviewing. And the same thing goes if you go into kind of communication literature about kind of business relationships or in the workplace, how to effectively communicate with your colleagues and coworkers. These are just good skills and tools to have in general. So let's talk about them and what they are. The ORs. These are your four main MI skills. And remembering, too, that motivational interviewing is not just about the skills, it's about the style of delivery, too. So you can do all of these things, but if it's not with that embodiment of compassion and acceptance and collaboration and evoking from the person their perspective and their reasons for change, then it's not it. Quite MI consistent. So don't forget about kind of all that early framework that we talked about kind of the way of being with another person that's so important. So these are the four key skills that are talked about in kind of basic motivational interviewing. So using open-ended questions, affirmations, reflections, and summarizing. And we're going to go through each of those skills and what they look like and how they might be used in a CF context. So open-ended questions. These are questions that can't be answered with yes or no, or a one-word response. Why is an open-ended question better than a closed question? It elicits more exploration of a topic. You actually get more information. So for healthcare providers, oftentimes you're kind of going through a checklist of information that you need to know. But oftentimes you'll actually get more information if you ask an open-ended question than a closed question. So if you ask someone, are you doing your vest treatments? They're probably just gonna say yes, because they know that's what you want to hear. But if you ask someone, how are things going with your vest treatments? Or what are some of the challenges you're having with doing your vest treatments? Then someone's gonna open up and be potentially a little bit more honest with you about what's going on. It also doesn't suggest an answer, so oftentimes we're very leading with our questions. So are you taking your enzymes every day? Yes, because that's what you want to hear, right? And it facilitates more of a dialogue and a conversation. And I think oftentimes healthcare providers express concern that, you know, if I'm too open, this is going to take a really long time. And the clinic visits are already really long. People, you know, want to get out of there, and I've got another patient to see and things like that. But studies have shown that this actually doesn't increase the length of conversation that much, maybe marginally, but in the process of asking open-ended questions, you're getting more of the answers that you need for all the subsequent closed-ended questions that you would have had to go through anyways. So we can play a little game called open or closed. So I'll ask you guys to chime in and say whether this question is open or closed. So have you been taking your enzymes, open or closed? You guys are good. In the past, what helped you get your weight up? Open. And it elicits to them some problem solving, so thinking about what has helped or worked in the past. And building on that previous strength, too. So you've done this before. What helped you? Aren't you worried about your lungs? Closed. And a little judgmental, too. Have you thought about doing your treatments after school? Closed. Again, that sounds like a helpful suggestion, like, maybe do them after school. But if the teen were able to kind of come up with that themselves, they'd be a lot more likely to kind of follow through with that than if you kind of offer them, like, have you thought about this? Have you thought about that? Why not try this or that? It kind of get into that yes, but match when you go down that path. What's been going well lately? Open and also positively framed, so focusing on the things that are going well versus barriers or complications or things that aren't going well, which are important pieces to also know about, but you're going to get those out of your visit. You're not necessarily going to talk about the things that are going well. What do you think would improve things? Open. And instead of you telling them what you think they should be doing or what could improve things or where they need to make changes, they're thinking about it for themselves. Are there things I could do more or less of that would help? Close. This one's a little tricky though, because you're like, but that sounds so helpful. That's a good one. I should write that down. But really asking more of how could I be more helpful would be, which is the next one, is more open-ended. Because oftentimes if you ask a teenager if there are things that you can do to help, their immediate response is gonna be no, leave me alone. So how could I be more helpful is kind of framed with this assumption that there are things that I could do that would be more helpful. So tell me what they are. And the same goes, I think, in, you know, with marital relationships or significant others too. Just asking, how can I be helpful? Not assuming what you could do that would help that person or what that person might need. Or asking what would be the best way for me to help, too. These are kind of great open-ended questions that you could use to kind of identify ways that you could be the most supportive. So again, this just kind of goes through the answers. You guys did a great job. So you want your open-ended questions to also focus on eliciting change talk. And this is something that we have learned over years of research on motivational interviewing, is that change talk really matters. So again, that's that darn cat. So thinking about someone's desire, ability, reasons, and need for change, and their commitment, activation, and steps that they're taking toward change. So in the past, a lot of motivational interviewing strategies, like a classic one that everyone still thinks about, is something called a decisional balance. So it's looking at like the reasons for change and the reasons not to change, and kind of allowing someone to explore both and allowing that to be okay. And again, you still want to have that kind of non-judgmental and accepting attitude of validating, yeah, there are things about this that aren't going to be easy or are hard, or reasons why, of course, you don't want to wake up another half an hour early to do this extra thing. But when you're going to get that kind of stuff anyways, those kinds of things are naturally going to come out in conversation. What you have to focus your efforts are on are kind of getting more of that change talk out, so open-ended questions that actually elicit or look for that. And so a couple of my favorite ones are things like, how do you think this might help or make a difference? Or if you were to add that in, how do you think that would feel? What have you noticed is different or better when you X, Y, or Z? This is a great one that helps kids and adolescents to kind of identify or articulate, like, well, again, some of those short-term day-to-day things that are actually better for them when they do their treatments. What's worked well for you in the past? So that's a great problem-solving one. It helps them build upon previous successes. What might some of the advantages be? And simply, what are your thoughts on that? So kind of inviting someone to be a more active participant in their conversation about care, getting their perspective and their input versus just telling things to them. So we'll move on to affirmations. Affirmations demonstrate appreciation for an individual's strengths, efforts, and qualities about them. So not just the outcome. So not just like praising or saying like, your PFTs are great, or like, it's so, your weight is so, you know, looks so much better at this appointment. You don't want to just praise or affirm the outcomes, because sometimes someone can be doing all of the things that they're supposed to be doing, and things, the outcomes are still not what you'd like them to be, because it's not entirely in their control. So what you want to do is you want to affirm qualities about that person, and also the behaviors that they are, the behaviors that they're doing that are kind of positive for their health. So even if their PFTs aren't up because they have an infection, if they're doing their airway clearance and they're adhering to their treatments, you want to still highlight and focus on all of the good things that they're doing. And you want to be genuine, too. So avoid the backhanded compliment, like, you've been doing such a great job with taking your enzymes. If only you had been doing that for the last 3 months. Like, you you want to avoid, you know, you want to be genuine and authentic in what you tell them. And so sometimes I'll have parents tell me, like, well, it's really hard for me to find anything to affirm. And I'm like, you can do this. There's got to be something. And maybe it's not related to their CF. Maybe it's how persistent or determined they are when it comes to their sports or their academics. So you can, again, broaden it to qualities about this person. Reflections. So this is, if I like had one skill to teach for motivational interviewing, this would probably be it. Reflections are one of your most powerful tools in communication, because this is where the heart of empathy and rapport building lies. Simple reflections are very basic. It's like looking in a mirror and repeating what you say back. So it's literally repeating what the person has said. And it's a way of confirming that you've actually heard and understood them. And so when it might sound crazy, like, why would I just repeat what someone just said to me? That sounds kind of annoying. But people actually love it in conversation. When you reflect what someone else has just told you, that shows that you were actually listening to them instead of just thinking about what you were going to say next. It shows that you were paying attention to them. And people don't usually pick up on the fact that you're repeating exactly what they just said, especially if you use a slight rephrasing of what they said, a rewording of what they said. And then there are complex reflections, which we'll talk a little bit more about in a later slide, that really kind of explore the underlying meaning or emotions and belief behind the statement. So they kind of help move the conversation forward. And again, we'll talk a little bit more about those types of reflections. But first, I want to share another video on reflections and what they look like and how they work.
I'm thinking of getting bangs.
Ooh, you totally should. You would be so cute with bangs. You have the face for it. I don't. Oh, there's my better half.
Cam, would you mind?
Hey, honey, where are you?
Oh, I'm on my way to Downey.
Oh, did you know Karen and Richard Carpenter grew up in Downey?
What a random and not helpful fact, Phil. I'm sorry, I'm having kind of a rough day.
Yeah, I'm kind of having a rough day myself.
Look, Phil, I need you to take care of dinner for me.
What's wrong?
Oh, Alex ripped Haley's favorite sweater, and now I'm driving around from store to store trying to find the exact same one before Haley finds out.
Don't do that. Just explain to her what happened.
Haley's not gonna understand.
Sure she will.
No, Phil, you don't understand. I'm trying to avoid this turning into a whole big thing.
Then just get her something close. She'll never know the difference.
Phil, could you just take care of dinner, sweetie? That's all I'm asking. That's it.
I'm just saying there's a simpler way to do this.
There is no simpler way. Just make dinner. Thank you.
Hello? Okay, I'm confused. You're saying that if she tells me she has a problem, I'm not supposed to help her?
Not unless she asked for your help.
But if she lets me help her, I can make her problem go away.
That is such a male thing to say.
Well, forgive me for being a man.
Mango or kiwi?
Ooh, kiwi.
When you say, you know, do this or do that, all she's hearing is, I'm smarter than you.
Believe me, she doesn't think that.
She doesn't want you to solve her problems. She just wants you to give her support so that she can solve her problems herself.
Yes, and sometimes she just wants a sympathetic ear.
Whoa. Maybe it's all the creams, but that just made sense, girlfriends. So if Claire says, I hate getting stuck in traffic, I shouldn't say, maybe you should leave earlier or don't get on the freeway. I should just say, I know, it's so frustrating.
Yes,
that's really? And if she says, the waiter I had today was so rude, I shouldn't say, maybe you should just order something on the menu for once. No. I should just say, what a jerk.
Yes!
And if she says, Phil, the TV's driving me crazy, I should just say, I know, there is not enough quality programming for women.
No. Turn off the damn TV.
Mm-hmm. Okay, now I'm confused again.
Doing with my sweater? Oh my God, it's ruined!
It was an accident!
I knew this would happen, you idiot!
Hey, let's try to get along.
I wish you was never even born!
They were trying to make one with a brain!
No! Honey, you guys are both pretty smart.
So that sweater, huh?
Yeah, it is. That sweater. And I did everything I can to stop them from fighting.
I don't understand why they can't see how much you love them.
I don't know. Meanwhile, Cheryl has been calling me all day because she's angry I didn't show up.
Doesn't Cheryl have a housekeeper and a nanny? Why does she need so much help?
I know, right?
You work so hard. You do so much.
I do.
Of course you do.
I do. I do. Oh, sweetie, thank you. I really appreciate that.
So these are examples that I use in my MI trainings with parents and with caregivers that I think really kind of, in a humorous way, illustrate some of these concepts. So the women that were in the salon had some great examples of ways to reflect. And then at the end there, you saw like a really nice affirmation that Phil did of kind of, you work so hard and you do so much. So types of complex reflections, adding an emotion, this can actually be, again, this is something that I do a lot in parenting interventions, is kind of emotion labeling for kids. So again, how you use these skills may be a little bit different depending on the age of the person that you're working with. So again, you're not going to be asking a five-year-old open-ended questions about when they want to do their treatments. You actually have to still, you know, put some limits and some structure in place. But if they're talking to you or expressing not wanting to do their treatments or not liking CF, adding an emotion, being able to label or identify for them and help them put words to their experience. Having CF is really a bummer sometimes. You really don't like having to spend so much time on your CF. And that's okay. Again, I think, again, the impulse is to make it better or remind them like why it's important anyways or why they need to do it. But sometimes, again, they just need to hear that you get it, that this stinks, this is a lot to deal with. Metaphors or kind of imagery can work well for a lot of people. So it's like water's pouring into the canoe and you can't bail it out fast enough, or it's like the straw that broke the camel's back. And then double-sided reflections, which are kind of, you know, if you think back to that scale where there's like, on the one hand, the reasons why you don't want to do this or why this stinks, and then on the other hand, the reasons why you really do want to do this or why this is important to you despite the fact that it stinks. And you always want to end on the change talk or the positive. So you want to start with the side about change that's not so good, end on the positive, the reasons why change is important. And instead of using a but, so like, I know you don't like drinking your Scandi shake, but this is what's going to help you gain weight and get your lung functioning up. Using an and instead, so like, I know you don't like drinking your Scandi shake, and at the same time, this is what's going to help you feel better and get your lung functioning up. Ways of forming a reflection. It can be helpful to start a reflection with one of these statements. So this is kind of like your easy go-to. If I'm not sure what to say, you can start with one of these phrases. You feel, sounds like, you're wondering if, you think, you realize. And we can try it with this. So I know I'm supposed to use my Toby, and it's just one extra step that I already have enough to keep up with as it is. There are many ways to reflect. There's no one right answer. There's no one reflection, but you want to reflect the change talk or the side of this person that actually does want to change, so, or does want to do the behavior that you want them to do. So sounds like you're already overwhelmed would be like an emotion-focused reflection. You're wondering if there's a way to streamline things. You want to keep things manageable. You already do a lot to manage your CF. You want to maximize the time that you spend. All of these things are better than saying, but you have to. Which is still true, but again, you're going to get farther if you use some of these skills and tools. And again, just like with open-ended questions, all reflections aren't created equal. So you want to reflect the change talk versus kind of getting trapped in this like reflecting pity party, which is what a lot of providers after an initial training with me would say is like, you know, I keep reflecting what they're saying, but I feel like we're just kind of getting stuck on like how miserable it is to have CF. And again, you do kind of get stuck there if you only focus on reflecting kind of the negative. What you want to do is, again, reflect and use your open-ended questions to guide someone more toward change talk. I'm going to skip this practice in the interest of time and move to another video because I like those.
Leave us.
Why did you do this, Allie? This is terrible.
Oh, great.
This is Michael's giraffe. He's crying now. Why did you do this?
Cause.
Cause is not an answer.
Active listening.
Ray, that doesn't work.
It works. I just use it on the worst kids in the neighborhood.
Would you? Look at this. Look what she did.
Try it.
No, Ray.
You want me to do it?
No. Do it. Okay. Allie, let's talk about what you did.
I don't want to talk.
Are you feeling angry?
Reflect back.
You're angry.
Yes.
Okay. That it's not okay to rip up toys when we're angry.
Judgmental.
You are angry because...
Because it used to be your toy.
Oh.
Yes. Hmm? I don't like my toy, Jeffrey.
I see. You think that Mommy and Daddy pay too much attention to Michael and Jeffrey.
Right, okay, I was handling this.
They get everything.
Right, and you're upset because we gave him your old giraffe.
I still liked it.
But you weren't playing with it.
But that doesn't matter, though, because it was still yours. And you're mad because we gave it to Michael without asking you, right?
Right.
Well, Mommy and Daddy made a mistake. And everybody makes mistakes, right, Mommy?
Yes, yes, yes.
You feel better now, Allie?
Yes, can I have the giraffe?
Well, it's broken, honey.
I know, I want to try to fix it for Michael.
Uh-huh. This way.
Thank you, Daddy.
See what I did there?
Yeah, yeah. Can't believe it. It's pretty amazing. Oh. You did it.
Anything else you need taken care of while I'm around here?
No.
What? What's the matter?
Nothing with you, obviously.
Don't go by me. I'm a natural. Where you get it?
Oh, look. Act so proud of yourself. Listen, if I hadn't dragged you to that stupid class, you'd still be standing there going, hey, no TV.
You're feeling inadequate because I mastered it before you.
Oh, don't give me that active listening crap. Where do you get off listening to me?
Never happened again.
So another funny example from popular media of reflective listening. And again, in the interest of time, I'm going to move forward a little bit more quickly with these last steps. Summarizing is really just kind of tying everything together, used to kind of wrap up a conversation or transition. So kind of verifying that you heard the important pieces of information. What I hear you saying is X, Y, and Z, and kind of almost like a bouquet, like you're gathering all these different pieces together and you're handing it back to the person. It can also be a time to kind of elicit more information, so asking what else. And then some of the steps with planning. So again, open-ended questions that you can use to kind of elicit what their first step might be or what the next best step might be, validating that it can be hard to tackle everything at once. And then when giving advice, always asking for their input first, what ideas they have about what might help. As a provider, kind of asking, you know, could we talk about some ideas together, using kind of wiggle words like perhaps or maybe, or a lot of people find that this is helpful. And then I want to share a little bit about the brief MI training, which you basically all just got, and how that went with the providers and parents at UNC. So I did this in kind of 15-minute segments at pulmonary division meetings and provided kind of a one-page cheat sheet for our providers as a quick reference and then was available for kind of ongoing coaching and support. And the majority of folks said that they preferred having that like brief training session versus one long-day training or a two-day training, which a lot of people had been offered before, but it's just hard to make the time for. And a lot of folks expressed interest in additional follow-up training sessions, which we did in kind of short segments. And the strategies they liked the most were the active listening, open-ended questions, eliciting patient input, and double-sided reflections. And then with parents, we tried this in a couple of different formats. So we did an MI training at a parent education night. We tried offering it over telehealth group-based sessions, but that was a little bit difficult for parents to all coordinate schedules. And so what was most successful was actually offering it during individual sessions in clinic, especially while teens were meeting with their providers individually for self-guided visits, meeting with the parents separately, and I also did some meeting with folks during their hospitalizations. I'm going to skip past some of these slides and basically jump to kind of satisfaction and outcomes. So people really liked that it was individualized. We thought people would prefer a group-based format, but people liked that it was individualized. They all felt like the training made them consider new ways of communicating and that the training was easy to understand. And they almost all agreed that they have noticed positive changes in how they communicate with their kids afterwards. A lot of folks really commented more on how it affected the quality of their relationship and their communication dynamics, so being able to have better conversations, their kids and teens feeling like their voices were heard and responded to. And oftentimes less about kind of a concrete behavior change, but more about kind of that relational dynamic, which is kind of the foundation for change. So leaving you with a few kind of quotes to kind of think about, especially the one in gray. So people are generally better persuaded by the reasons which they have themselves discovered than by those which have come into the mind of others. I think that's a really great way of kind of summarizing the heart of motivational interviewing. So I don't know if we have very much time for questions and answers, but I will be around for the panel tomorrow.